Hello and welcome to our water and foam tutorial for Reflow. In this lesson, we are going to show you how to simulate interacting fluids with different densities. A typical example for such a project is water and foam. Let's start with a glass, although there is not too much to say about it. The object has been modeled in a 3D program with solid walls and then exported to Reflow. Then we also need a gravity daemon and a diverso circle emitter. The associated domain will be added automatically and rename it to dye_water. The first step, the emitter has to be scaled and oriented to create a nice stream along the glass's inner side. It normally takes some tests to find working position and rotation values, but with diverso you don't have to worry about slow simulations. And to get a pouring effect, we add an expression to the Z rotation axis instead of keys. Depending on your axis setup, you might have to use the Y coordinate. And if you want to change Reflow's axis setup settings, just take a look at the preferences section. But let's go back to the expression. What I want to achieve here is an oscillating rotation between 4 and 10 degrees, but you might apply other values. An oscillation can also be seen as a series of ups and downs, and a sine function is the perfect representation. Start with sine from t, where t will be replaced by the current time. The result is a curve oscillating between -1 and 1 degrees. To make the curve higher, we multiply a factor, for example, 3. And now the amplitude is between -3 and 3. We also have to shift the entire curve along the vertical axis, and this is done by adding a value. With 3, for example, the amplitude ranges within 0 and 6. So we have to add another 4 units to get values between 4 and 10. We also want to change the number of oscillations, the so-called frequency. This is done by multiplying time with a factor. Higher values create more ups and downs, and in this scene, we're going to work with a factor of 10. When you scrub the timeline, you can see the emitter's oscillation. Now we can go ahead and adjust emitter speed and randomness. Here, a speed of 5 will be used, and the random values care for more realism. The fluid itself is managed by the domain. Set the type to liquid SPH. SPH is slower than PVD, but it gives us much better results here. For testing purposes, the resolution will be around 20, and a surface tension of 10 will also create more drops. Time for the first simulation. As you see, some particles leave the glass, but there are a few methods to improve fluid object collision. And the first step should always be to enable continuous collision detection. So let's give it another try with this option. We still lose some particles, and therefore we should take a look at the collision mesh. Go to Display Volume and activate Isosurface. To get a better view, change the glass to Bounding Box. And now we can see that there are holes and gaps, and one method to get rid of these holes is to decrease cell size. With 0.025, we get a perfect representation of the glass. Of course, such a small cell size increases RAM usage and simulation times, but the most important thing is that our object will be watertight. Then it might also happen that some splash particles leave the scene. To delete them, add a K-volume daemon and resize it to catch the escaping particles. Finally, a K-isolated daemon helps to remove stray particles. To get rid of them immediately, set isolated time to 0.01 seconds. And now I think it's time for another test. This looks much better, but we definitely need more particles to fill our glass. A second circle emitter helps us to accomplish that. What we are going to do is to switch on the second emitter when the particles hit the glass, and this happens around frame 25. This means that we are going to animate the speed parameter, but first we have to drag the emitter to the glass's bottom and let it point upwards. If necessary, you can also scale the emitter. Then set an animation key at frame 25, speed is 0, and at frame 30, the emitter should have a speed of 3. For a smooth filling behavior, open the curve editor and turn the keys into Bezier points. Now it's also a good opportunity to adjust the glass's parameters for the interaction with the fluid. Most probably you have to experiment a little with different settings here. And then we are ready for another simulation. The result is good, although it would be nice to have more splashes. As always in such a case, we add a noise field daemon, but this time with a limited scope. In Reflow 10, the noise daemon's bounded option has been removed because this effect can also be achieved with a falloff. Our daemon should only affect particles inside the glass, so check Enable falloff and Display falloff. Set falloff bounds to sphere, and now the daemon can be resized. The falloff zone is the area between the dashed and the full circle. To make the zone smaller, decrease falloff percent. With 0, you have exactly the same behavior as with the old bounded option, but here a value of 0.3 appears to be more appropriate. Finally, adjust strength and space scale to your needs and give the simulation another go. As expected, the new simulation shows much more drops and turbulence. We also have nice splashes and the particles don't leave the glass anymore. This means that we are ready to create the foam. For this purpose, we need another diverser domain. Rename it to die_foam. An emitter is not required because we don't want to create new particles. We only want to shift them from water to foam. With this kind of simulation, it's also very important that both domains share the same resolution to avoid exploding particles. The foam's density is 400 here to make the particles rise. Higher external pressure creates a slightly stronger expansion, and surface tension helps to create bubble-like structures. In order to separate the foam from the water visually, you can set the second domain's color to pure white. Finally, we need a condition that will tag some particles as foam and shift them to the die foam domain. This is done through a filter daemon. Specify target and source domains and define a condition. After several tests, I have found out that vorticity gives the best results. So when a water particle's vorticity is at least 80, the particle is considered foam and will be shifted. But before we can really make use of this property, it has to be activated in the domain's particle channels. To get a better view of the fluid, just make the daemons invisible and we set the final resolution to 150. Alright, we're done and can start a last simulation. And here is our final result with lots of drops, nice swirls and turbulent bubbles. The foam particles rise because of the lower density, and if you want to create the impression of dissolving foam, you can add a KH daemon, for example. As always, thanks for your attention and have fun with Reflow 10. Goodbye!